I thank the Academy for the opportunity to share some of my work, some of our work from the lab to this audience. So this is my current laboratory. The past and present members who have contributed to work, without whom none of the work would have been accomplished. And these are the different funding agencies who have helped me run the laboratory over the years. So I thank all of them for their contributions. For today's talk, I'll be focusing on the work by two students. One is Poonam Mishra and another is Divyansh Mittal. The two of their work is what I'm going to be focusing for today's talk. So among the several dogmas about the brain, one of the general dogmas is that the brain is an organ that is made of repeating homogeneous structures. So you have these neurons, which are simple computational units that are present, and there are repeating homogeneous structures that are present on this particular structure. And you are able to make this system function because of the connectivity associated with it. But if you look at the biology of it and ask if this dogma, if this assumption that the brain is made of these homogeneous structures, is it really true? Then it turns out that, I mean, across brain regions, if you look at the kind of neurons that are present, they are very heterogeneous. There are structural heterogeneities that are present across different types of different brain regions, and there are different types of cells that are present in different brain regions across the brain. So these are some examples from within the same brain region, basically. And if you look at, say, for instance, granule cells in a brain region called the dentate gyrus, you see that they have very different morphologies in terms of how exactly they look like. So these are another class of neurons in another brain region called CA1. And here also you see that there are significant heterogeneities in terms of how their structure manifests. In addition to this, there are certain brain regions, the dentate gyrus being one, where what are adult neurogenesis expresses. So these are brain regions where you have new neurons born, even in the adult brain, actually. So in these structures, you would see that there are new neurons born, and therefore you would see that there are structural heterogeneities even here. So these are the number of days that you observe over here, and you see that the dendritic arborization, the branches that you observe over here, become more and more complex as the number of days exist. And these cells coexist with the more mature ones, and therefore, at a given point in time, the dentate gyrus has granule cells, which has different ages and different structures consequently. So there are these different structural heterogeneities associated with these structures. In addition to this, if you look at the functional properties of these, so this is patch clamp electrophysiology experiments done by Poonam. And if you look at this, you see that these are, I mean, dentate gyrus granule cells. And you see that she is injecting a 250 picoampere current into this particular cell. And she has a certain kind of firing pattern elicited. If you count the number of action potentials over a period of 1 second, that comes to around 26 hertz. But is it going to be 26 hertz for each of these cells present over here? No. If you look at it across different cells that she recorded, you see that there is significant heterogeneity in terms of how many action potentials that these cell types can fire in response to the same stimulus. Some of them are not even eliciting firing. Some of them are eliciting action potentials at a very high firing rate, actually. Right? So there are different kinds of heterogeneities in neural circuits. Those are just examples of that. So there are some things which are called as local heterogeneities. These are associated with the structural properties of the cell, the intrinsic properties of the cell, which include the molecular composition and the cellular physiology of which firing rate is one example. And synaptic connectivity. So you see that there are synapses which have higher strengths, there are synapses which have lower strengths, and so on and so forth. And therefore, you have these heterogeneities as well existing in these kind of neural circuits. In addition to these local heterogeneities, you have also heterogeneities coming from the external, the brain regions which are external to this particular circuit that you are interested in, where you could have all these neurons that are present in this particular location to get exactly the same inputs from the other neurons outside, or you could have each of these different neurons over here getting different kinds of inputs. So that would constitute a heterogeneity that is coming from the external domain associated with reference to this particular structure that you are interested in now, right? So these are some of the these are the set of heterogeneities that are expressed in neural system. So what exactly are the functions associated? Why are they expressed in these kinds of neural circuits? One of the questions I would like to take up is whether these heterogeneities that are expressed in neural circuits are a mechanism to serve what is called as degeneracy, right? So degeneracy, this review, this influential review by Gerard Edelman, who switched over to neuroscience after his Nobel Prize in immunology, wrote this influential review in 2001, where he defined degeneracy as the ability of elements that are structurally different to perform the same function or yield the same output. Remember that it is not redundancy, because redundancy is a scenario where the same function is performed by identical element. If one fails, another kind of the same type takes over, basically. On the other hand, here, degeneracy involves structurally different elements, basically. So I'll give you an example. So this is a modeling study involving dentate gyrus neurons, again by Poonam. So you have six different neurons having very similar firing patterns, very similar gain, and how they respond to various different current injections. But if you, if you look at the measurements associated with them, they are very, very similar to each other, basically. So you have these neurons having very similar characteristic functional properties associated with granule cells. But if you look at the underlying channel properties that are yielding this particular set of models, you would see that they are all over the place, right? So you see that there are this many number of channels that are present with different parameters governing different aspects of this particular channel function. And what Poonam showed was that you could get very similar functional outcomes from heterogeneous channel properties that are underlying these models. So if you just are measuring the properties associated with any channel density over here, like say, for instance, if you take the calcium-dependent potassium channel and measure the density of these channels in the neuronal model, you see that there is significant heterogeneity over here. But that is looking at only this particular channel and not looking at the global picture. So if you look at the global picture, all of this is towards contributing towards this functional outcome where you want this kind of a degeneracy in function. So if you have a degeneracy at the neuronal scale, at the cellular scale, that would lead to, or that would manifest as the heterogeneities in the molecular scale, here molecular scale being the ion channel scale, basically, right? So then if you look at the functions of the network, of the dentate gyrus network, so the previous one was with reference to cellular scale function. Now, if you ask a question about what exactly is the function of the DG network, the dentate gyrus network, one of the prominent postulates is that it is responsible for what is called in the literature as a decorrelation. So the idea is that if you present this kind of a network with very similar input patterns, it is capable of discriminating between them. So the inputs are similar, but if you look at the output of this particular structure, it would be very different and thereby capable of discriminating between these two individuals who are shown over here. What Poonam showed was that you can get the same kind of decorrelation, the ability to discriminate, by having different kind of heterogeneities, right? So this is a scenario, the curve at the end is a scenario where you have a homogeneous population of networks, neurons, sorry. And here you see that the correlation is pretty high. So the input is not, the system is not able to discriminate between the patterns that are coming in. Now, on the other hand, if you have intrinsic heterogeneities, which is heterogeneities in the firing properties and the other things that are present, then this kind of a system is capable of decorrelating. That is only with reference to input heterogeneities. And if you have different kind of structures that are present as a consequence of adult neurogenesis, that also is capable of introducing additional decorrelation. And therefore, if you are interested in a certain level of decorrelation that is to be extracted from this particular network, you can get that through different kinds of heterogeneities that are expressed in the system. So then more interestingly, what she showed was if you have afferent heterogeneities, so that is, I mean, each and every neuron is getting different kind of inputs, so that would make the system to behave in a such a way that all the local heterogeneities do not matter, right? So the afferent heterogeneities are kind of the dominant heterogeneities that rule over these local heterogeneities. So, and as a consequence of that, you would see degeneracy in the network scale outcome. In this case, it is decorrelation. Now, but that would imply that for getting the same amount of decorrelation, different networks could use different combinations of molecular and cellular parameters, leading to what we define as degeneracy, basically. Right. So if that is the case, what exactly are the role of these local circuit heterogeneities? In what she showed was she perturbed the system by virtually knocking out these ion channels one by one, and showed that if you do not have structural heterogeneities, there is a large impact of these perturbation on the system performance. But if you have structural heterogeneities, that brings in a certain amount of robustness. So you can see the range of these perturbations that you observe over here. Here it is smaller, here it is larger. The difference between these two scenarios is that here you have structural heterogeneities, here you don't have structural heterogeneities, right? So this was an example where the heterogeneities formed a substrate for decorrelation and robustness in this particular circuit. So we have shown degeneracy across different cell types, different functions, and this is a summary slide of all those things. And this is a review that we wrote 2 years ago about the kind of work that goes on in the lab on degeneracy. Let me switch gears. We will switch over to the medial entorhinal cortex. So this is another brain region which has been shown to be involved in spatial navigation by having these kind of cell types. So these are called as grid cells. So what you are seeing over here is that you are allowing an animal to traverse along this particular trajectory. So the blacks are basically the trajectory, and you are recording from a single neuron in the medial entorhinal cortex. And you observe that the red dots are where the neurons are firing. So now if you take the firing rates of this particular neuron and plot that as a heat map, you see that this particular neuron doesn't fire arbitrarily at any possible location, but it is forming a kind of a triangular pattern, a grid-like structure. It is tessellating the entire space, external space, as grids, basically. So these are called as grid cells, basically. Right? So these grid cells, one of the things that people have been interested in terms of the grid cells is what exactly are the origins of this? How do neurons come about making this? And one of the most well-established models that is employed for assessing this is what is called as the continuous attractor network model. I will not go into details of this. So I'm just going to take this particular model, and I'm going to ask questions about what exactly is the impact of the different kinds of heterogeneities on this kind of a model in terms of generating this grid pattern that is shown over here. This is work by Divyansh, and he also had introduced different kind of heterogeneities into the model. So this is intrinsic heterogeneity on a parameter that governs the integration of inputs that are coming onto this particular structure. Heterogeneity means it is lower amount of heterogeneity. So you see that the variability is lower, and degree 5 heterogeneity is a large amount of heterogeneity in the parameter that is governing the intrinsic properties of the cell. He had afferent heterogeneities. So this is a parameter that couples the velocity of the animal to neural function. So here also you see that there are 5 different degrees, the lower one being lesser heterogeneity and the higher one. The higher numbers translating to higher degree of heterogeneities. He also changed the synaptic connectivity. So there is a certain synaptic strength that is required for the emergence of this kind of grid pattern firing in this particular model, which would look like this, a negative weight, which is spread over like this, basically as a function of distance from that neuron from other neurons. So he introduced a jitter into this particular structure with different levels of error. So the highest error is what you see as the fifth degree of heterogeneity, basically, right? So then he asked, what exactly would this do to the grid pattern generation, basically? Right? The low degrees of heterogeneity, you see that the grid pattern generation is pretty effective. There is, clear generation of grid pattern firing in this particular network. But as you increase the amount of heterogeneity, you see that, especially in these three heterogeneities, except for the intrinsic heterogeneity, so here you see that there is no grid pattern firing at all when you go to either the afferent or the synaptic heterogeneity, or when you have all the heterogeneities expressed together, you see that the grid pattern firing is completely gone now. So the question that he asked was, okay, in a real system, all these heterogeneities are expressed together. And how is that that particular system is capable of generating this pattern when I am not able to do this in the model? So he then asked questions about what exactly is heterogeneity, what exactly are heterogeneities doing, and how exactly are they perturbing the emergence of this particular grid pattern firing. So he found that the heterogeneity induced perturbations were limited to the lower frequency range, right? So he took the firing rates of neurons and he asked what was the difference between the firing of neurons in a homogeneous network and the neurons in the heterogeneous network with different degrees of heterogeneity, right? And he observed that there was not much of a difference in the higher frequencies at all. He found that it was limited only to the lower frequency range. Then he asked, if this is indeed the case, then I can suppress the lower frequency neural activity and that would give me back the grid pattern neural activity, right? So that was his hypothesis. So to test that, he can't just arbitrarily suppress the frequency. So he has to, resort to some kind of a biologically relevant way of doing it. And he noticed again that the neurons in the entorhinal cortex, they expressed what is called as a resonance, right? So if you present inputs of different frequencies, then neurons actually respond maximally to one particular frequency. It's not like a low pass filter, it's a band pass structure. There is resonance expressed in these kinds of structures. This is something that is biologically present in the entorhinal cells that act as grid cells, basically. So he introduced resonance into this cell in using two different ways. He artificially introduced an additional high pass filter, which gave him a resonance kind of a structure on top of the neuron itself, which is an integrated structure. And second, what he did was he introduced resonance by this slow feedback loop that will reduce this low frequency region. So you can see that in these kinds of, if you compare the resonator, which is in red in both the cases, with the integrator, which is in black, you see that predominantly there is a suppression of lower frequencies and you're not doing anything to the higher frequencies at all, right? So he thought that, okay, if I implement this in the neuron, so the original model had an integrator kind of a circuit and it did not account for this fact that entorhinal neurons are resonators. So he incorporated that and while the integrators were strongly affected by the expression of heterogeneities, if he had resonators, irrespective of whether he was introducing it using an artificial high pass filter or using an actual feedback loop, which is how these conductances actually work, which is slow, he found that he was able to maintain grid pattern firing in the resonator kind of a network. Right? So this is an example where the heterogeneities perturbed the system, which was not completely accounting for the intrinsic properties of the neurons. But if you account for those, you see that you manage to get back the grid pattern activity in a manner that you would expect. So to summarize my talk, neural circuits are not made of repeating homogeneous computational units. That's just a popular myth. Several forms of neural circuit heterogeneities are present, intrinsic, synaptic, structural, and afferent. Heterogeneities reflect the expression of degeneracy in emergent functions. So if you have degeneracy in the cellular scale, that would mean that there is heterogeneities in the molecular scale, in the ion channel scale, and stuff like that. Neural circuit heterogeneities could form the substrate for robust functional emergence and also yield resilience to perturbations. I give you an examples of decorrelation in dentate gyrus. And I showed that if you have perturbation, if you have heterogeneity in the network, then that would result in perturbation in the network function. And I told you that neuronal resonance could act as a generalized stabilizing mechanism to protect neural circuits from the deleterious impacts of circuit heterogeneities. So two important take-home messages are to measure and account for all neuronal properties. If there is a resonator, please make it a resonator, not as an integrator. And the other one is experimental analysis and computational models should account for the complexity of neural system and account for all the neural circuit heterogeneities rather than assuming that they are repeating simple computational units. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rishi. You have a couple of questions. Are you okay sure. to take them?
Yes, please, sir.
Right. So there was a question from Dinesh Kumar who asked whether neurons from young and aged brains differ in structural or functional heterogeneity.
There are differences. So developmentally and in the young adults, in the adult animals, there are differences in terms of structural functional properties and the synaptic connectivity and stuff like that. So this has been well characterized across different neural structures. So the answer is yes, there are differences.
Okay, and the next question is from Somdatta Sinha. How do you address phenomena like epilepsy in these models?
So epilepsy in these kind of models, so it depends upon the models for epilepsy. It depends upon the question, of course. And I mean, one of the ways to pose that question is: are the heterogeneities different are the neuronal properties different in epileptic animal models? Let's say, and the answer would be yes. So you would have differences in terms of neuronal properties, the structural properties, the synaptic connectivity and the number of neurons, all that would be different compared to the control animal. And if you want to incorporate those into these kind of models, you would say, for instance, if you know that a certain ion channel has been reduced or increased, you could perturb that particular thing in this particular model and ask questions about what is the implication of that. So you could bring in each of those parameters, structure, function, and stuff like that. And make sure that each of that is accounted for in these models and ask questions about how that would alter function. Briefly, I mean.
Okay. I just have one last question for me. You mentioned degeneracy and you mentioned redundancy. Where is plasticity in all of this? So how would you define plasticity?
I didn't talk about plasticity. I didn't want to put this yet. We are doing another work where we are asking questions about if there are differences in intrinsic property, if there are heterogeneities in intrinsic properties, synaptic properties, and structural properties, how does it affect the plasticity profiles themselves? So what do I mean by plasticity profile? So a given neuron changes its synapse by a certain proportion if you give it a certain frequency of stimulation, basically. So the question is, how do these heterogeneities affect the plasticity profile themselves? And what we have shown is that each of these heterogeneities themselves could affect the plasticity profiles. But if you have a specific combination of these heterogeneities coming together, then that could yield exactly the same plasticity profile, irrespective of differences in synaptic, intrinsic, and structural properties. So you can have the same plasticity profile where one compensates for the other, basically. So there are different ion channels, receptors that are present.
Okay.
So each of them can contribute to, compensate for each other, thereby yielding a scenario where the plasticity profile is exactly the same. So we have that in the pipeline. I didn't want to yet put it
here. Sure.
Thank you,
Rishi, for a very interesting. There are a couple more questions, but you can look in the chat box and reply to
I will
those
try
questions.
And answer them.
Thank you so much.